Before we proceed with our stewardship program, we're going to go ahead and discuss a little bit about the divine liturgy today, especially since today we celebrate a newly revealed saint, Saint Iakovos of Evia, last name was Tsiklis, from the monastery of Osios David of Saint David. And he is a saint that loved liturgy. No matter if he was sick, if he was tired, if he was traveling, whatever he was, and in whatever shape he was, he would celebrate the divine liturgy. And during the divine liturgy, he would always feel better to serve it. He's an example for all of us priests who sometimes feel tired or maybe not in the mood, you know, to celebrate the divine liturgy or not prepared. You know, he was always prepared to celebrate the divine liturgy, and that's a great encouragement to all of us. And I think we all priests should pray to him to give us strength and inspire us in our priestly works. So last time we discussed about the proskomidi, which happens before people even come to the church. Usually it happens either before Orthros or during Orthros, depending if you have good chanters and you have a chance to relax and do the services in the altar there. But once the doxology ends and we sing the last troparia for Orthros, we start the divine liturgy. And if we started the Orthros with a blessing, blessed is our God, now we start the divine liturgy with blessed is the kingdom. And we say blessed is the kingdom because wherever Christ is, there is the kingdom of God. And what is liturgy other than the revelation of Christ to the world? It's the transformation of the gifts of our life, bread and wine, into the body and blood of Christ when he is fully present in our midst here during the divine liturgy. And so the presence of Christ transformed earth into heavens, transformed a regular place like Euless, Texas, that nobody heard about except for us who live here, into the kingdom of heaven. Right? So it's important. But it's also important to know that in this blessing, we also call the Holy Trinity to show that Christ is not just a prophet. He's not just a teacher. He's not just a moralist. He is the Son of God, one of the Holy Trinity. That's why we say, blessed is the kingdom of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And you make the sign of the cross over the holy table on which lays the antimension, because the cross is the symbol of this kingdom. Christ showed himself that he is Christ. How? By dying on that cross. So now the cross is the symbol of Christ, is the symbol of the kingdom of God. Then after this, we start singing, you know, the first petition, which is a series of requests that the deacon leads the people into, and the people reply with, Lord, have mercy. The real prayer is, Lord, have mercy. But the deacon leads us into what we need mercy for. For the peace from above, for the salvation of our souls, for union of all people, for the president of our country, for all the armed forces, for everything that is needed in our lives. And all of this can be summed in one word, the word that we start with. In Greek, this petition is called the Irinika, which means the petition of peace, because we start with, in peace let us pray to the Lord, which shows us that in order for us to pray, we need to have peace in our hearts. We cannot pray with a troubled heart. We cannot pray by being upset on somebody. We cannot pray when we are troubled and anxious and depressed and all these things. But we have to try to find some level of peace before we come into the services. And because God knows that sometimes it's difficult, we start praying to God to give us peace. And we start the liturgy with this calming set of petitions to bring peace to our souls, that God will provide with everything we need. Be at peace. God will take care of you. After this, we end up with an ekphonis, right, which is an ending. The priest always says different endings, right, at the different set of petitions. The first one is, for to you belong all glory, honor, and worship, together with the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and ever, and to the ages of ages. And the people say, Amen. That means that the prayer that the priest raises to God is acknowledged by the people, and they are one with the deacon and with the priest in praying that prayer to God. After this, we start what we call the antiphons. The antiphons basically are different psalms that are recited or chanted by the different choirs. Usually we had two choirs, and they will take, each one will take one verse. When I had my shoulder in a sling and Father Nectarios was singing, you realize how during the Divine Liturgy we would switch between the left and the right choir, or chanter in our case because of the pandemic, and we will go like this. Sometimes the typica, which is the last service before the Divine Liturgy, is incorporated in the Divine Liturgy, and we have full psalms that are actually recited antiphonally by the two. Regularly in parish practice, we kind of shorten that, so we don't do the typica, and we just say some of the verses of the psalms in between the refrains, which for the first antiphon are Most Holy Theotokos, save us, and the second one, save us, O Son of God, with different endings. If it's Sunday, who is risen from the dead, or if it's a weekday, who are glorified in your saints, or can be for a feast, who are crucified in the flesh, or circumcised in the flesh, or who is born from a virgin, or who ascended into heaven, and so forth. We have different endings for that. So we have two of those, and in between them, we have what we call small petitions, which is a kind of a shortened version of the first one, kind of an intermezzo to after we sang some, then we pray some more for the different things that we need. We always end, at the end of every set of petitions, we always end with a prayer to the Theotokos, so we can remember that the Theotokos is our ultimate intercessor, that we ask to God, but we realize that sometimes it's difficult to go all the way there to him, and we go a little closer to his mother, who's the closest to him, whose prayer he cannot ignore. And we always pray to the Theotokos. The third antiphon is generally a little bit more complicated because it's usually related with a day that we celebrate, with a celebration that is current. If it's Sunday, we sing the Troparia of the Resurrection, right, on the different eight modes. And every Sunday, we sing another one. If it's a feast like it was to today, we sing the Troparion of the feast. Today we sang the Troparion of the entrance of the Theotokos in the temple. Today is the prelude of our salvation and so forth as the Troparion goes. Then we have the entrance. After the first Troparion, we have the entrance. The entrance used to be done from another building. The emperor would come, the bishop would come from another building, and they would enter at that time in the church before the reading of the epistle and of the gospel, okay? Now, since we don't come from another building, I've been here since 7:30, kind of hiding in the altar there. Right now, we're exiting from the altar and we enter into the church. However, if the bishop is present, the bishop does not enter but waits at the throne until this entrance, when he comes in the middle of the church and accompanied by the priest, at that time enters into the altar, right? So just to make sure that we understand kind of where all this come from. The petition, the entrance is a procession. And in the procession, we have several elements. We have, first of all, we have candles, lit candles, that represents obviously the resurrection of Christ, but they also represent the light that was sent in front of Christ in the Old Testament, which is the prophets, right? So the prophet, especially the holy prophet John the Baptist, the protector of our church, is the one that prepared the entrance of the Lord in the world. And after that, we have all these fans that you can see in the back of the church here behind the altar there, that are also called exapteriga. And if you look at them closely, you will see the cherubim with six wings, the seraphim with six wings, and that's why exapteriga means actually six wings, which showed us that it's not just the prophet and the saints that are there, but also we have a parallel liturgy that happens at the same time with us as part of ours, which is the angelic divine liturgy. Actually, Saint Iakovos that we celebrate today, many times he, especially during the cherubim hymn, which we'll discuss about it a little bit later, he would feel the presence of the angels during the divine liturgy. And sometimes he would feel kind of wings kind of touching his face during the entrance. And then after that comes the deacon with a with the gospel. The gospel is the word of God, the logos, which means the Son of God. So it represents Christ himself, followed after that by the priest or the bishop. And then we enter into the Holy of the Holies there. After we enter there, we finish the festal troparia. We sing usually the troparion of the feast, the troparion of the day, if it's the week, a weekday. And at the end, we end with the conducion, which is another hymn dedicated to the festal period in which we are. As you know, our feasts are not just one day. Sometimes we have several weeks of the same feast, and usually we sing the hymns attached to that feast, associated with that feast for several times. After this is done, we start singing the Trisagion hymn. The Trisagion hymn actually in Greek means thrice holy, because we say, Holy God, Holy Mighty, Holy Immortal, have mercy on us. The hymn is compiled from the Bible in Isaiah 6:3, when the angels are singing, Holy, 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 and also from one of the Psalms of David, Psalm 41. We just read this the other day, if you do the Psalter reading that we're doing, which says that God is mighty and immortal, right? And so this it's a compilation there. Now, this has a dual meaning. One says that God, who is holy God, is God the Father, who's the source of all Holy Trinity. God the Mighty is the Son, which is the Logos of God, speaks with great power. And God the Holy God, Holy Mighty, Holy Immortal is the Holy Spirit that gives life. But in the same time, God the Father is Holy, Mighty, and Immortal. The Son is Holy, Mighty, and Immortal. And the Holy Spirit is Holy, Mighty, and Immortal. And repeat that three times for the Divine Trinity. So it's got this double meaning there. And at the end, we ask mercy, right? Because always we ask God for mercy. So it's not just, it's a hymn in which we praise the Lord as he is mighty, holy, and immortal, but we also ask that it is his mightiness, in his immortality, and in his power to have mercy on us, okay? So that's until now, that's what we are talking about. Next Sunday, the kids are not going to have Sunday school, so we will be able to catch up, because we are one lesson behind versus the kids, so we can get back into the same place. And next time we'll speak about the readings from the gospel and the epistle and what follows after that, as we will see.